Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the April 20th, 1999 meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. First item on the agenda is approval of the minutes of the previous meeting, which is going to be postponed to our next regularly scheduled meeting, as there was an error in copying some of the minutes to some members of the board. Correspondence received for this meeting: a memorandum from Michael McGovern in regards to Cross Hill, letter from the town attorney in regards to Cross Hill, letter from M. Reed in regards to Hemlock Hill, a letter from W. Bray regards Hemlock Hill, a letter from B. Springer in regards to Hemlock Hill, a letter from C. May in regards to Hemlock Hill, a letter from A. Rowe in regards to Hemlock Hill, a letter from S. Steinman regards Hemlock Hill, a letter from D. Lorry 3999 in regards to Hemlock Hill, a letter from D. Lorry 4199 in regards to Hemlock Hill, a letter from the town attorney 32999 in regards to Hemlock Hill, correspondence concerning the 1999 conference on the urban sprawl, communications tower article, and planning board goals for the coming year. In addition, there were items on the podium this evening. Another memorandum. Who is this from? John Tui of Tui Associates in regards to Hemlock Hill subdivision. A letter from Fitzpatrick Associates in regards to Hemlock Hill subdivision. Okay, that was addressed to John Tui. Another letter from Fitzpatrick Associates in regards to Hemlock Hill subdivision. Mailed to the members of the Woodcrest Road neighborhood. A letter in regards to Hemlock Hill from A.R. Martin. A letter from David Lorry dated April 15th, 1999 in regards to Hemlock Hill. A letter from Libby DeMille in regards to Hemlock Hill. And a letter from Mr. and Mrs. Robert N. Steele in regards to Hemlock Hill. I believe that's everything. Lots of reading this week. Any comments on the correspondence from members of the board? First article on the agenda is the consent agenda.
Mr. Chairman, I have to excuse myself for this particular item.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst. Maureen, you want to give us just a quick description?
Certainly. This is the Dominicus Crossing subdivision approved by the Planning Board. There is a request to approve a new owner. They haven't done this in a long time, so we went to the town attorney and asked him what kind of action would be needed. The town attorney agreed that because there is one standard in the subdivision review that talks about the financial and technical capability of the applicant, this would be considered an amendment to the subdivision and therefore requiring approval by the Planning Board. So what you're being asked to do is review the new owner and determine whether or not they have financial and technical capability. That information is provided in your packet this evening. This item has been placed as a consent agenda item, so the board has the option of either one, approving it as a consent agenda item, or two, if a board member would like to discuss this further, you can pull it off the consent agenda and put it on the regular agenda.
What are the wishes of the board? Mr. Emery.
Mr. Chairman, I would request, I just have a very quick question, but I recall when the development proposal came before the board next door that it was quite a concern of the public and others as to who the officers of the corporation were or are, and I would request the same information with this application. We've seen most of the, at least the local representatives from the prior development, and walked the land with them together. I think it's very important in a small community like this for the planning board to have a sense of who they're dealing with.
Any other comments from the board? Do you wish to put off making a motion until Mr. Emery's request is made complete?
No.
Mr. Emery?
I'll make a motion that the consent agenda item be approved with the following revision, and that is that the offices of the corporation be provided to the town manager and the planning director.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Mr. Perez, you have any comments? No? Okay. Go right ahead.
Questions? I don't really have anything other to say, but we will provide that information to the town manager and town planner. No problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
No further discussion. All those in favor of the motion, please signify by raising your right hand. It is unanimous. Thank you. Please note that Mr. Parkhurst is again seated with the board. Under old business, the first item on the agenda is the Tinsman Retail Building Addition. Request by Tom Tinsman for a site plan review of a proposed addition to the ERA Real Estate Office located at 349 Ocean House Road, Section 19-9, site plan review. Mr. Tinsman, go right ahead.
Thank you. My name is Tom Tinsman. I'm the owner of the property at 349 Ocean House Road. And we're back before the board tonight with some revisions to our original site plan. And I'd just like to highlight some of the changes that we have made to the plan and then discuss whatever changes there are. First of all, we did adjust the size of the building. We reduced the size by taking 3 feet off the end of the building. And we also took away the back porch that overhung by the parking lot and indented that into the building. So we gained another, well, we actually lost another 240 square feet there. So the total reduction of the square footage in the building is 372 feet between now and last time. What we also did was readjust the parking requirements. We have installed 24-foot traffic aisles in the parking lot, which is an increase over what we had last time. We've also put in a drive around in the parking lot, so you can now completely drive around the parking lot instead of having two dead ends. And that was accomplished by putting in a 12-foot aisle in the back of the parking lot. We've relocated the dumpster to a more appropriate site, and we'll be fencing it in on all sides. I think the plan here actually shows that it's fenced on three sides, but we plan on fencing it on four sides. We've also reconfigured the sidewalks to show that the sidewalks will be mostly on my property so that we don't disturb any current trees or have a significant amount of work to do off the site. We've moved the compact car spaces to get a better alignment, and we've widened the sidewalk on the back of the building to 6 feet where the cars will be parking up to the back of the building. Those are the major changes. And I'm here to discuss whatever else we need to talk about.
Thank you, Mr. Tinsmith, for taking our concerns to note. Any questions from members of the board? Right ahead, Ms. Emery.
Tom, would you just take a minute for the benefit of anyone that's watching and listening to describe the parking, the shared parking concept and how that was calculated?
Yes. What we've done on the parking is not to go with a straight usage of square footage of the building to determine the parking. If we did use just the square footage of the building for retail space, we would currently have a need for 38.7 spaces, and we're showing that we have 45 spaces on the plan. However, one of the uses that we want to incorporate into the building is a coffee shop, which figures its parking differently. When you're talking about a coffee shop, you take the number of seats and divide by four to get the required parking numbers. What we've done is we've calculated that roughly 50 seats will be used in the coffee shop, which when factored in with the divisor of four plus a staff of four comes out to 16.5 parking spaces required for the coffee shop. If we were to leave that coffee shop as just retail space, it's going into a space of just under 1,000 square feet. So on a retail requirement, that would require four parking spaces when you take in the divisor of 250 square feet needed per parking spot. But because it is a coffee shop, the requirement is much, much higher. It's 16.5 instead of four. So in order to have the 45 spaces fit the needs of the building, we looked at the use of the building in terms of which required parking spaces would be used at certain times and which ones wouldn't be. Looking at the different peak hours of each business that would be located in the facility. And to do that, we've come up with a schematic showing that there were breakdowns on the times of usage. 6 to 8 in the morning, 8 to 5 during the day, and 5 to 10 at night. And then, of course, for the apartments, 10 p.m. at night till 6 in the morning. Our feeling is that having a varied use, not having all the businesses be the same types of businesses and not all having the same needs as far as people coming to use the spaces, we've broke it up into those categories and calculated that at the peak time of the usage will be between 8 and 5 p.m., 8 a.m. and 5 p.m., which shows us that we would probably need 43.3 parking spaces of the 45 available. When you take in consideration the square foot of the retail space and the needs of the coffee shop, with the divisor of four for the coffee shop, it's showing that the potential need for parking spaces is going to be 51.4. And of course, showing 45 spaces, we wonder how can you fit 51 cars in 45 spaces, and it's not easy to do. So that's why we came up with the different peak times of usage versus the times that some of these businesses won't be using those. Our assumptions are that the apartments will need the parking spaces in the evening and most likely not during the daylight hours. But we're not showing that they're all going to disappear. We're showing that most likely 3 out of those 8 required spaces will still be there during the day. And that's if there are even going to be 8 cars. We're allowing 2 per unit for the apartments. So the real kicker here is the fact that that coffee shop taking about 1,000 square feet has pushed our need for parking by about 12.5 spaces higher than a retail space would need for that same space. Does that answer your question?
Yes, it does. I guess I'm not quite clear on the concept of shared parking. If each residential unit doesn't have at least one parking space, in the event either there's a visitor there or it's two people sharing an apartment or a couple with two cars, it would seem to me that there would be at least a need during, I mean, for example, this week, in Cape Elizabeth, I know nobody's here except for us, but during that time, it would seem to me that it would be very rude to be an apartment owner, I mean, renting an apartment and come down and, or come home and not find a place for the car. So I think that the calculation should assume at least one car per, in the shared concept, one car for each apartment. I don't have any factual reason to say that, but it would seem to be a reasonable and a fair thing to assume. How many square feet per seat in the, excuse me, in the coffee shop get you to 50 seats?
Well, it's a space of about 1,000 square feet.
So that's roughly 20 square feet per person? Is that how that was calculated?
You want to talk about how you count?
It was, what we did is we actually laid out a little place center to see. We have some storage areas and some cooking areas and bar areas and stuff and bathrooms. And the remaining area, we put in some seats and see how many could fit in. And it takes some shoehorning to even get 50 in, but we put about 50.
Because the other way to approach that is to knowing how much kitchen or whatever area you need is to whatever the leftover square footage is. The code will only allow so many seatings per square foot.
For exit requirements and stuff.
Yes. And has that calculation been done yet?
No.
So that, in effect, depending upon the layout of the bathrooms and the service area and so forth, it's possible that you may not, by code, have as many as 50 seats. Or let me ask, is it possible that you may not have as many as 50 seats?
Going into this, we decided to aim for 50 seats, and I think we can probably get 50 seats in there, but not going to... It may end up 48 or 50, I don't know. It's close, I would think.
Is the apartment above the real estate office existing?
Not currently.
Just for the audience's information, it's actually hanging on the wall there. We have schematic layouts of the interior of the building, and normally that's a code enforcement issue, not a planning issue, but because of the issue of shared parking, I'm just trying to figure out how the building works. There's a rear set of stairs shown, or back stairs. Is that the primary access to the third floor apartment?
No, that would be the primary access for that apartment would be through the front door facing Route 77.
Is there an interior vestibule that locks out that front entrance from the real estate office?
Yes, with fire-rated doors.
Okay. My question would be, have we met the requirement for landscaping within the parking area for this application?
There's two specific requirements. One is that you can't have 10 parking spaces in a row without having a landscape island, and I believe the applicant does meet that requirement. Mm-hmm. The other requirement talks generally about buffering around a parking lot. And that's a decision the board needs to make. The buffering standard talks about requiring less rigorous or substantial buffering between compatible uses versus less compatible uses.
I guess for lack of any other term, and I don't know if it's because of the way it's drawn, the elevations of the plan, and because this is in the town center, there's a design review aspect that the board has for architectural issues. The design of the building, the elevation is very schematic. I think you would agree, Bill, that it's not, I mean, at least as I see it, there aren't materials called out, there aren't sizes for the window. And I guess what I'm curious about is, what is this going to look like when it goes to the code enforcement officer for a building permit, and what control does the planning director of planning have over what we're seeing here this evening? Because I know that as you go through more detailed design, things often change and can look quite different. If the prices come in too high and the windows could suddenly be smaller and the whole sort of proportion that you're showing with this facade could change dramatically. I think what I'm suggesting is it would be appropriate to have at least typical window sizes called out if the intent is that the windows on the final building are going to look like the ones we're seeing this evening.
Is that, that's a code requirement, though, right? Or is it a design requirement?
In the town center zone, it talks about a whole bunch of design issues, scale, proportion, and the only way that the planning board knows what those are about is to have something on the drawing that at least gives us a sense. The drawing depicts a sense of scale because we see the overall building and then we see the windows depicted, but unless we know that the types of windows I mean, there's supposed to be compatibility. I don't know the exact language. I don't have it in front of me, but there's discussion about being consistent with existing architecture in the town center in terms of the window types and the building mass and the height and all those issues.
Mr. Parkhurst?
Question for Maureen. When someone comes in to pull a building permit, do they have to present something more than what we have in front of us? Do they have to have full architectural plans?
Yes, they do, because they need to show the building inspector that they're going to build the building to meet building code and that it's not going to fall down. So I don't review building permits, and I don't see building plans that often, so I'm not speaking specifically to you, but I know there are certain cases where he actually has to see the sizes of roof members and the sizes of walls. So yes, he gets additional information. However, the building permit that he issues is supposed to be for a building that looks like the one that the board approved. And he has been pulling planning board files to confirm that what he's issuing for building permits is consistent with what has been approved by the planning board. Just to get back to Mr. Emery's comment, there are several design standards in the town center guidelines, and the one that he was referring to is under E, openings. And specifically what it says is that the relationship between doors and windows to exterior wall space of a building creates a rhythm or pattern. The pattern of window or door openings of a structure should be compatible with the rhythm of openings in nearby structures. Doors and windows should be consistent with the style of the building. Development of existing structures should maintain the original rhythm and size of openings. The first floor facade should be constructed with an equal proportion of openings to wall space. So that is a standard that you are asked to apply.
Reason for my asking the question, if we put in a condition in the approval that fenestration, roof pitch, et cetera, has to meet the town center guidelines, is that something the code enforcement officer will check as well?
The planning board is the one that decides whether or not a project complies with the town center guidelines. If you said that you want to make sure that the building permit is issued for a building that looks like the building you have, that would do it. And if, say, for example, the code officer gets a design and there's four windows across the large gable, but they're obviously a lot smaller than what you've seen, then he may kick that back to the planning board. Right now, there are no sizes on the windows. Yes, there is a code requirement for a minimum size, and certainly I don't think there's a code requirement for a maximum size. So.
But we don't have, we have very, very few dimensions here. We don't have roof pitch. Yeah, I understand probably the applicant is trying to get this passed before he goes to the expense of full plans, but it leaves us in an awkward spot. I mean, if we approve, you know, this, it's a line drawing that doesn't really tell us a whole bunch.
I guess I'd like to pick up on that. There's a phase of drawing in architecture referred to as schematic design, which is sort of it's the early stages of design, and within that, typically the height of the building, the windows might be called out as double-hung wood windows or vinyl windows. Siding might be called out as whatever it is, and then the overall building dimensions would be given in the roof slopes. It allows to have the configuration of the building and the finishes essentially gives a description of the building without having to go to the expense of having a full set of design drawings completed. But there's nothing in front of us that I, unless I'm missing something, there's no labels at all on this in terms of what the building finish is. So if this drawing comes in, if Bruce has this, our code enforcement officer has this in his file, and a set of drawings comes in that doesn't look like this at all, he really has nothing to, based on these plans, to evaluate whether or not it meets the criteria that the board, if the board were approved this evening. I would feel most comfortable if this were tabled and the schematic design information was, the labels were added to the drawings and that the overall dimensions were provided in the floor plans. Something is the rear elevation of the building is just not dimensioned. It is in section on sheet one. But I think this leaves this planning board in, I guess, a very delicate situation in terms of what's approved and what isn't, unless we want to get the architect up this evening and commit to describing the building for the public record, but I don't know if that's adequate for the rest of the board.
Well, I'm a little surprised this is my third night here with basically the same plans for the windows drawn and the heights and everything, and this is the first time I've heard that request.
I don't want it to come back to the planning board. If you open up the ordinance, it's very common, Tom, very common. If you go to the city of Portland and present a building, they want to know what the brick is. They want to know the type of brick. It's very common to say if it's going to be vinyl shingles, just say vinyl shingles. If it's going to be wood shingles on the roof, I know that the abutters, if this were a public hearing, would want to know that. Certainly when we had the building next door here, that was all a very critical issue. It's spelled out in the ordinance. How does Bruce Smith make a determination as to what we approve this evening if the plan isn't labeled?
Well, I assume he goes by the code.
There is no code. I mean, there's the zoning ordinance, but there's nothing here. He doesn't know if we've approved cementitious clapboards, wood shingles, vinyl siding. Just don't know.
Well, the siding is referred to in the plans, and I'm just shocked to come here tonight and hear this for the first time. No, you go to the building inspector and get a permit, you have to go by the codes and you have to go by the approval of the planning board. And I can see what you're saying. If it's a 3x6 window and you want to do it a 3.5x6, that's going to alter it.
Well, let's just say for discussion purposes, and I don't want to get contentious and carry this on, but just for discussion purposes, for whatever reason, you got a deal on cobalt blue stain or cobalt blue vinyl siding. Suddenly this building goes up at 3.5 stories with cobalt blue vinyl siding. Someone calls me up and says, what the heck is the planning board up to? And I say, well, we had the drawings in front of us and I didn't see any note regarding cobalt blue vinyl siding. Bruce Smith gets a set of plans, doesn't say anything about cobalt blue vinyl siding. So you've got the best of both worlds. There's no protection from the town side and you're able to do whatever you want to.
Well, I mean, is that a code violation to put up cobalt blue?
I don't think it's consistent with the town center guidelines.
Well, it would be in the town center guidelines then if it's against the guidelines.
Well, we're supposed to be reviewing those standards this evening. It's not something that Bruce Smith, acting as dictator of the town standards, is left to do. The planning board is in the position to make that determination. And I guess I'll let what I've said well enough be alone, and that'll be it.
Mr. Parkhurst.
Try to find a solution to this. I understand what Mr. Emery is saying, and I know what I've said earlier. I understand where the applicant is. If we add a condition to the approval, if that's what we do, that says something to the effect that all dimensions and roof pitches and roof and window openings, et cetera, and all materials on this, the building, be according to the town center zone guidelines, is that going to make everyone feel okay or not? I don't know how else to do it without asking for the applicant to come back next month with a plan that actually specifies, what we're using for roof shingles, what the roof pitch is, what the windows are, what the siding is. I mean,
Mr. Parkhurst, if I may.
Who would enforce that?
Well, the code enforcement officer, I believe, has the power to do that.
Maureen, would you like to comment?
Make a suggestion?
Okay.
I think what you're talking about gets at the problem. The only concern I continue to have is that you're delegating a responsibility to a staff person, and he may not be comfortable with it, and it may not be appropriate to delegate to him. Obviously, I think that the most cautious, conservative approach would be to have the applicant add all these details onto the elevations for the building and come back next month. But another approach might be to require that the applicant put all of this information on the building permit application, and that the final building permit application would come back to the planning board for a review of all of the exterior appearance of the building.
Next month.
It would come back to the board whenever the applicant has submitted a building permit application to the building inspector.
A question for Maureen. Could this be done, assuming Tom and his architect, you know, can put this, I assume that they know pretty much what they want to do anyway. If they were to submit this to you, we look at this the next workshop? Or can that not be done because it's a public meeting?
All meetings of the planning board are public meetings. We could have the board look at this at a workshop, and the consideration of the exterior could be a consent agenda item. It could be as simple as possible. If the only concern is that, I think the concern is that the applicant is proposing a building that we all agree with, or that we all sounds good, but there's nothing on the plans that actually ties that down. And what we need to do is, in the end, we need to have a plan that ties all of that down. The question is there a way to do this that creates the least timing problem for the applicant and the planning board?
Is it appropriate to ask the applicant how he feels about
that's
this?
That's what I'd like to do.
Mr. Tinsman?
I feel that's a good solution. I mean, if I did not see anywhere in the submission data that you needed measurements on all those things, so that's our mistake. My belief was that you run that by the building inspector and he reviews the codes and makes sure that everything's in order. I can see what Mr. Emery's point is. You know, if the windows do change a little bit, is that going to change the aesthetics? But at the same time, those are code things. I guess I'm not getting the full point on that. If there's a way for me to submit that data to you, we can get that information to you. There's certainly not going to be an attempt to give you one plan and try to put up something different. I mean, we've been working with these plans for a long time. And I think the design criteria is good. I think the design is very, very good. And that's what we're planning on putting up. But that's not to say I won't come across a real good deal on cobalt blue. I may.
So
I can see what you're saying.
Would be.
So you. That would be a good solution.
Okay.
I think.
All right.
Mr. Tinsman, a memo that came across our desk, I think, along with the this month's submission mentioned that the plans would be looked at by the state fire marshal. Have you gone over things like whether or not there will need to be more exterior stairs, or whether where you will need egress windows and such in terms of the sizes of the windows in the building?
Bill Nemers did meet with the fire marshal's office, and their conclusion was that the accessibility was good. The ground floor is certainly accessible, and the pitch of the sidewalk was acceptable to them.
In terms of fire safety, egress from the bedrooms in all of the apartments, typically in residential construction, you have to have bigger windows in the bedrooms so that they can be used in an emergency situation. have the sizes and the heights above grade shown on these plans been accepted by the local fire chief?
We talked to the local fire chief. We had a meeting with him, and I think Maureen could verify this, but I think his conclusion was everything was fine. We've agreed to sprinkler the building, which, you know, was a big thing for them, and quite frankly for us. We want it to be a safe building. And we're, in addition to that, we don't have to, but in addition to that, we are going to fire rate the stairwells so that we're going to have not only sprinklered, which you would need if they weren't fire rated, or fire rated if it wasn't sprinkled, we're going to do both.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Griffin?
I have a first question for Maureen. Regarding the town center plan for the sidewalks, is there any plan that goes south beyond the IGA?
The town center plan, and Tom was a member of that committee as well as Tom Emery, the committee recommended sidewalks on both sides of the street throughout the town center district. So if you were, the recommendation would have started on the northern end of Ocean House Road where the Methodist Church is and the Tarbox Triangle, running both sides of Ocean House Road all the way through the center of town down to the intersection with Fowler Road and Old Ocean House Road. What we have right now is a grant to start construction on what we're calling phase one of that sidewalk project, with the hope that at someday we may be able to actually implement all of the recommendations in the town center plan. But right now, the sidewalks that we have money to build start on Scott Dyer Road at Farm Hill Road, extend on the south side of Scott Dyer Road to Ocean House Road, and then extend south on Ocean House Road on the western side of Ocean House Road, stop at Jordan Way. You know, the hope would be at some point that we'd be able to continue it down, but there's no funding for that at this time.
Are most of the sidewalks on town property or private property?
All of the sidewalks are on town property.
So if we looked at the sidewalks that Tom proposes here, some of them are on private property. You
right.
Then have to have an easement.
Yes, and we've talked to the applicant about that, and it's proposed as a condition of approval that what we're calling a public access easement. So it basically is, it remains the applicant's property, but we get an easement over the area of the sidewalk so that it would actually function as just like any other town sidewalk.
Tom, your sidewalk across the front is 5 feet. Am I correct? Is that the way I see it? The one on Ocean House?
Yes.
Now, the one going down to the school property down that way is 4 feet?
Correct.
Is there a way that you could increase that to 5 so it complies with a typical town sidewalk?
We can add a foot to it if we had to. I mean, is it a requirement to be 5, or is that?
Is a standard sidewalk for the town, Maureen, 5 feet?
At least.
Okay. It would probably make sense that that one would be 5, and then it would comply.
We could do that. Yeah.
Mr. Parkhurst?
quick question. On the plan that you have up on the board, Tom, the front sidewalk is delineated in brown. On the plan I have here in front of me, it's white because it's a black and white drawing, but there seems to be a square that comes out into the sidewalk from the front door of the new addition. Is that just a pad, or is that steps, or what is that?
That's going to be a bench with some plantings.
In the middle of the sidewalk.
You're talking about this one right here?
No, well, it starts at the street side of the sidewalk and goes straight back to the building.
It's the entrance. It's your entrance.
Here? Okay, on the top part of it?
Yeah, I mean, it seems to interrupt the sidewalk that goes in front of the building. Is that steps, or is it just a a platform or pad or whatever you want to call it that sort of directs people to the building?
There are no steps there. That is handicap accessible in that area.
Thanks.
Mr. Emery.
Three other comments. I don't want you to get discouraged, Tom. I generally like the building. I think it's a benefit to the town center. I know if you can get this open fast enough, you'd be selling more coffee than McDonald's sells hamburgers. One question. I don't see how a code enforcement officer knows which trees are to be saved and which aren't. How is that noted on the plans? Because I know you're working, you know, you're trying very
yeah.
hard.
To I'll have Bill explain which ones are staying.
I said we've noted the trees that are going to be remaining are on the site plan, on the landscape plan, the trees that are in the area of the buildings. Are not shown on the plan, I guess.
Then do I take it when I look at the planting schedule, if it says existing tree, it means existing tree to remain? Is that, for example, Bill, on the site plan, on page 2, there's open circles in front of the building and along the
right.
high school drive. All those are existing trees that are to remain.
Those to remain, right.
Okay. And that's... I asked Maureen, does that note need to be added to the drawing, Maureen?
I'm sorry, what note was that?
Should it specifically state that the tree is existing tree to remain?
Yes, that should be made clear.
That can be a condition of approval. The other question, and I think, Bill, you could answer this as well, is that I think before, for accessibility to the front of the building, you had accessible parking spaces behind the building and a ramp up toward the high school sidewalk area.
Right there.
So now for accessible, they park in the accessible parking space?
Parking, accessible parking space right here. And this is just a normal sidewalk to street curving mm-hmm. thing up to this level. And from this level all the way around here, it is,
the grade is greater than 1 in 20.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
There's no elevator within the building?
We are in discussions with the fire marshal right now as to whether and not we need one. There are some technical issues. We've been talking with Alpha One and trying to make sure we get all the things together. I do not think we're going to need an elevator. In fact, that's our way we are planning it at this point.
Does Alpha One consider this a reasonable accommodation for accessibility to the coffee shop?
We have talked with Dennis Pratt and he sees that doesn't see anything wrong with this right now, no.
Has the state fire marshal's office reviewed this for accessibility?
Yes, he has.
Boy, I just don't see how it does. I mean, if I'm wheelchair bound, I've got to park in a parking space, go onto the lot, then I've got to backpedal down a slope through a parking lot, up onto a sidewalk, and then all the way around the building and through the front door. I'll leave that up to the code enforcement officers, but that doesn't, anything that I've ever learned about accommodation, that just seems to be under a renovation situation or an unusual situation. I can understand that, but I just don't see how that flies in this situation. But we'll let the reviewers make that determination.
Yes, Nancy, go right ahead.
What about a handicapped person having access to the third floor? To the apartments?
It won't be accessible.
Is that legal?
Yes. There are no ADA guidelines for residential units unless they receive federal funding. And unfortunately, I mean, there's only going to be three apartments on the upper floor, and they'll be privately used. So, but currently there are no regulations that say you have to provide handicap accessibility to residential.
Are there state regulations under the either the tenement law or the state accessibility requirements that you're
according to the Alpha One in the Fire Marshal's office, no.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Wilcox.
There are regulations requiring accessibility to market rate housing, but they are federal HUD requirements called the Fair Housing Act.
Right, with federal money.
But they have different approaches also, but they do govern everywhere.
Right, and we were told if federal funding is provided for a building, then 10% of the units have to be handicap accessible.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Wilcox.
Correction, the Fair Housing Act requires access to market rate housing that is not subsidized by the federal government, that if you build something and offer it to the public, depending on the number of units and the severity of the site access, it has to be accessible.
Okay, would this fall under that?
I'm not sure. It might be something you might want to check, though.
It's only three units.
Only a few
so
units,
I think it falls under the limits.
It might not, yeah. Okay, good.
All set. Mr. Parkhurst.
I'd like to make a motion.
Please.
Motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, Tom Tinsman is requesting site plan review for the Airy Bend Center, a retail slash office slash apartment building addition located adjacent to the existing building located at 349 Ocean House Road. Number two, circulation in the parking lot will be enhanced by delineating parking spaces, aisles, and turnaround areas. Number three, most of the proposed pedestrian walkway system is located on private property. Number four, the application substantially complies with section 19-9 site plan review. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Tom Tinsman for site plan review of the Airy Bend Center retail slash office slash apartment project located adjacent to the existing building located at 349 Ocean House Road be approved with the following conditions. Number one, that the plans be revised to incorporate the town engineer's comments dated 4/12/99. Number two, that a note be added to the plans that the parking lot shall be striped as depicted on sheet three. Number three, that public access easements for the proposed sidewalks on the applicant's lot be submitted to the town planner in a form acceptable to town attorney and town manager. Number four, that the building permit application include detailed information regarding exterior treatment of building, including but not limited to exterior materials, roof pitches, window openings, and dimensions. The building permit shall not be approved until the exterior treatment info has been reviewed and approved by the planning board as consistent with the site plan and the town center design standards. Number five, that the proposed sidewalk along the school driveway be widened 5 feet. Number six, that a note which identifies trees to preserve be added to the plan. And number seven, that there be no alteration of the site nor building permit issued until the plans have been revised to reflect the conditions on the approval and submitted to the town planner for review and approval.
Thank you, Mr. Parkhurst.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Matson. Any further discussion of the proposed motion? Mr. Emery.
My suspicion is that this will pass this evening, and as I just said, Tom and I served on the committee. I'm going to vote the way I'm going to vote, and I feel that I should explain why. My sense is that if this is the standard that we're going to have for the level of plan quality that we're going to be reviewing town center projects for, then I think it puts the planning board a bit behind the eight ball. And I want to have it understood very clearly. I'm going to vote the way I am, not because I object to the project. I think it's a wonderful project, and I fully support it. But I think the drawings have to be clarified. I think there should be more information on them. As an example, the assisted living facility that was approved on Scott Dyer Road, if we were to look at those early architectural plans and look at the level of drawing on those, and again, allow for a smaller applicant, I fully understand that. But this is a fairly large commercial building. It's one of the first in the town center. So I fully support the applicant. I support the project, but I'm going to vote the way I am tonight because of, I think the information puts us at a disadvantage.
Further comments from the board? We have a motion and a second. All those in favor, please raise your right hand. All those opposed? There was one opposed. Thank you, Mr. Tinsman.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Parkhurst.
Is this an appropriate time to somehow get the wheels in motion for the next application that comes before us, the town center zone, that you don't keep it in the position against it?
It's a very good comment.
Excuse me.
Anytime the board feels that there's something missing from plans, they want to say it at a meeting, it makes it possible for me to make future applicants aware of what your expectations are.
You know, Mr. Emery certainly had a very valid point. It seems to me with the time and expense and trouble that we all went through to get the town center standards done and the drawings done for the zoning ordinance, et cetera, that the least that we could receive as planning board members is detailed drawings. And with roof pitches and materials depicted, et cetera. So if there's any way of doing that, I don't know how we go about doing it, but however we do it, we should.
Do any other board members have any comments concerning Mr. Emery and Mr. Parkhurst's comments about being a bit stricter with submitted plans in the town center zone? Mr. Wilcox?
I think that it might be a good idea that under sort of our completeness checklist that it that it specifically address, you know, all materials of the exterior and dimensions of the exterior be shown. And then it would become a completeness issue and not, you know, right off the bat, and not something to just sort of speculate about as the application goes through successive meetings.
Perhaps when an application is concerning and placed in the town center zone plan, that there be an amendment, if you will, to a checklist for applications in the town center zone. Mr. Emery.
Let me just comment on that. I don't disagree with that. I mean, that's, I think, the applicant before us now, and anyone who's involved in going before planning boards, the great struggle that any applicant has is you have to spend $1 billion to get standing before the board. You'd have that completeness checklist, and if you're paranoid about the way in which the board's going to review the project, if the project's contentious, any other number of reasons, then you have to make the drawings 100% complete, or an arbitrary board in other communities could just dismiss you at hand saying it's not complete. I think the board has used the workshop process in the past to try to get to issues that may not be. What I don't want to see happen is to have the completeness checklist be confused with the issue of completeness, minimal completeness, versus the issue of is that what the board likes to see. I think that there was plenty of time from the time that this project was deemed complete to add additional information. I think there were two subsequent submittals. So I think you're right. Just, you know, as the pendulum likes to swing extreme in both ways, maybe we have to be more diligent when we go through the completeness checklist in the town center.
Very well.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda, Hemlock Hill subdivision amendments. Maureen, do you have any comments before we begin?
Not at all.
Go right ahead, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Thank you for hearing us tonight. My name is Owens McCullough. I'm a civil engineer with the firm of Sebago Technics. Here tonight on behalf of Fitzpatrick, Joel Fitzpatrick, for the Hemlock Hill subdivision. With me tonight is Kelly Fitzpatrick, Joel Fitzpatrick, and Sally Daggett from Jensen, Barrett, Gardner, and Henry. If the board pleases, I could go through a brief presentation summarizing from the last meeting to where we're at now, and we'd certainly be glad to answer questions.
Go right ahead.
Great, thank you. We were last before the board on March 16th for a public hearing. We listened very carefully during that meeting. There was a lot of good input from both the board and the public. After that meeting, we met with Maureen and compared notes so that we could try to address all of the questions and concerns that were brought forward from that meeting. We've worked hard over the last, last month, since that meeting to address those comments, and we did prepare a submittal package. My cover letter was very long, about 5 pages, because we wanted to very carefully go through each of the items. The applicant views this as an important project. We tried to listen very carefully to all the concerns. As we see it, there are really, I've sort of tried to look at how all of the issues fell out, and there are really 4 main areas. And if I can, I'll try to go through those. The first one was stormwater management. And I know there was a lot of concern and discussions around that at the last meeting. The design of this project is very straightforward as far as stormwater management goes. When you build a site, you get an increase in runoff. You have to mitigate that increase so that you're not discharging more than what was coming off the site before. We're going to accomplish that by constructing a detention area adjacent Oakhurst Road here. And that area in there is designed to accommodate enough volume to mitigate the increase in runoff that was generated from this project. So in effect, what will be discharging from this site will be at or below pre-development rates. And calculations actually suggest that it'll be less than what was coming off in the pre-development. We spent considerable time looking at that. I know there's a lot of discussion about the Cape Woods development. We looked closely at that. We went through the town files. We've involved the town engineer, the public works director, spent a lot of time going through that. Steve Harding, the town's engineer, has issued a letter, which I believe is attached to Maureen's staff report, and I think that pretty well explains out our approach and how we're proposing to address stormwater. And I won't go in great detail into that, but I believe, in taking all that time to work through them, we've come up with a design that's practical and that works. We did also, as one of the conditions that the town engineer recommended was copy of correspondence for obtaining the permit by rule from the DEP. That's a 1-page form that we filled out and actually sent in back on March 1st, and it's 14 days. If you don't hear back from them, it's approved. We didn't hear anything back. Supposedly on the form, it says they're supposed to send a copy to the town. Whether they did or not, I don't know, but I did bring copies of that tonight that I can leave with Maureen for the records. We always send those out certified mail, so just a signature on the bottom that the DEP did receive that, and I have a copy of that also, and I'll leave a copy of that with Maureen. And maybe if I could just have Mark pass that on down, that would be great, and I won't forget. So that, I didn't hear anything back from the DEP, and that was well over a month ago, so the way their regulations are set up, that crossing is approved. Another item that was discussed was the construction, basically on 3 of the lots. And those are lots 5, 6, and 7. There was some steep slopes on those lots. There was some discussion about how that would be constructed on those lots. We did take a lot of time to develop a tentative grading plan for each of the lots so that we knew that there was an appropriate building window on those lots. And I think I talked about that last meeting. I'm sorry if I'm being redundant. Since that meeting, though, one thing the board asked for was that it would be helpful to have some cross sections through those lots. And so what we did was we did do, I believe it was 2 cross sections, and those are on 11 by 17 format. I believe they're labeled cross sections A and B. And so it sort of gives you an idea of how that lot looks in section as it is now and as it will be when it's constructed. The slopes will be somewhat similar in some areas as to what's there now. There will be fill on some of the lots. We went an extra step on this whole process to place more restrictive notation and erosion and sedimentation control requirements on each of those lots. And I think Steve Harding mentioned that in his review letter. That includes And I'll have to refer over this. I should have used a different highlighter. That doesn't show up real good. But we added it. We have some notes right on the plan here that the contractor needs to pay special attention to erosion and sedimentation control requirements, and that all areas have to be stabilized and maintained throughout construction. There's a standard detail sheet that has two columns of notation that follow best management practices. I don't have that up here, but it is on the detail sheet and part of the plan set. We did add some special notation in through here on the slope construction requirements to stabilize within 24 hours of placement. Basically, what we like to do is loam, seed it, and put an erosion control blanket over those slopes. That's the mesh with the, it's usually like a hay mulch in between the mesh, and that gets anchored to the slopes. Also, as part of it, we did show dimensional standards for the buffers, the setbacks on the from the property lines to the limits of clearing. We came up with a very specific clearing plan on the project. We did specify the vegetative buffers to remain assigned dimensional standards. That was a request that the board had made. I think it was to have something to reference when they start construction, something that is specific as far as what those dimensions need to be. So we did add those directly to the plans. We also added a notation directly on the subdivision plan, and I apologize, I don't remember which of the board members brought it up, but there was a discussion about grading. You know, when say lot 11 gets built and then lot 12 goes next, there may be a need to grade a little bit onto from lot 12 back onto lot 11. So what we did was, and that was a very good point, we added some notation sets onto the plans, essentially setting up a 15-foot sideline easement extending 15 feet on each side of the property line so that as these lots are developed, there'll be rights to go on to the subsequent lots to make sure that the grading is completed appropriately and that positive drainage is maintained. And that's note 21 on the subdivision plan. Mr. Cohen, who lives in this house right here, Mr. and Mrs. Cohen, I apologize, who live in that house there, had some concern that they had a driveway culvert, and they were concerned that as we develop lot one, there might be the potential to block their drainage, creating a problem for their driveway crossing. So what we wanted to do was make it very clear that that couldn't happen. So a note 20 was added directly on the subdivision plan that will, of course, be recorded in the registry, and it will be something that the town can reference and enforce. And that note is, and Joel's aware of that too, Joel will be involved in this through the whole project, is that the existing culvert, that we shall maintain the drainage and not block that drainage coming from that culvert. So we wanted to be sensitive to that. As I said at the last meeting, the applicant will be developing and building the houses on these on each of these lots. He would like to work with the land as he goes along. We submitted some photos and some examples of the types of houses that he would be building. He's pretty excited about all of this and to have the potential to develop a very nice neighborhood. The next item that was of some discussion was traffic, and that mostly centered around safety issues at the Woodcrest Road. When we first started this project, we were very careful to look at that whole situation. We had a meeting out on site with the town engineer, the public works director, Maureen attended. We spent a lot of time looking at that before we moved forward with the project. And the town has established standards that are intended or specific to the town of Cape Elizabeth to follow the comprehensive plan and the goals and objectives of that. So we were careful to develop a design that adhered to that. I think Maureen prepared a memo in her staff report that very well outlined that. And I'll just go through that very quickly. It's my understanding in 1992 that Cape Elizabeth Planning Board recommended to the town council a package for road classifications and standards. I understand that this was really a couple of years of work to look at it. And basically, they reviewed standards by the ITE, the Institute of Transportation Engineers, and, quote, neo-traditional town planners, some contrast in the standards. The town wanted to develop a design that fit the rural character of the town, and as a result, they developed these specific standards for the town, which we can adhere to and we are planning to adhere to. And these meet, our design meets that. We think it'll work very well. The site distances falls within that range that the town classification set up. And I won't go any more in detail into that memo. I'm sure all of you have read it, but we'd be glad to talk about it. I'm sure Maureen could help me out on that if there are any questions as we go on. The next item, which was item three, was buffering. And I really sort of already just covered that when I went through the stormwater drainage. Again, I believe Mr. Emery brought that up about specific dimensions for that buffering. And what we did was, on our grading plan, which is sheet 4 of 8, we specified, especially along these back lots here, which are backing up to Cape Woods, we added some notation about leaving a 10-foot vegetative buffer from the rear property line. And we went on beyond that so that in case there are holes, which we all know in 10-foot, you know, a tree, there'll be one tree and there can be a hole in an area that needs to be infilled. We went further and developed a note with a little help from Maureen that basically that the developer shall plant up to 4 hemlock trees per lot, a 5 to 6 foot initial height, along the property lines of lots 2 through 5, that's these lots in through here. And those, the locations would be determined in coordination, consultation with the tree warden, and so that we can look at where the best place to put those. If the vegetation is adequate as determined by the tree warden, then those trees may not be planted. But that provision is made part of would be made part of the approved plan, so that there might be some infilling along that buffering if needed. Then also along this other side through here, we actually added dimensions for the vegetative buffer to remain. It's essentially 20 feet and 15 feet, and then of course it goes to the 100 feet along the RP1 wetland in there. So what we've tried to add some specific information to the plan that can be followed. Again, Joel will be involved in the construction. You know, it's our hope to flag those limits carefully, and there are some specific notation on the plan, so if those are violated, there's something to come back and say, well, the plan said 15 feet, now you've only got 10 feet. So we tried to address that. The fourth item was some legal issues basically surrounding lot conformance. And I'm not an attorney, so I'm not going to go much into that other than at reviewing all the correspondence, there's been a number of reviews done on this same issue by the town's attorney and the applicant's attorney. And it's my understanding that both the applicant's and the town's attorney are in agreement with that and have been in agreement really since the beginning of this project, because that was one of the things we were very careful to look at the onset of the project, was the issue around lot conformance, size of the lots. And I believe that has been addressed. Sally Daggett is here tonight. If the board has questions on that, she would be more than happy to elaborate on that. But I'm going to defer that on those legal issues. There were a couple of miscellaneous items. One, the road name, which was originally Bellwood Road, and I'll have to look at Joel on this, but I believe there was another town name in the town that was similar to that, and we were asked to look at a different name. The applicant has come up with Abaco Road, A-B-A-C-O. I think the plan spells it A-B-O-C-A, so I will have to correct that. And that name came up from a name that the applicant was looking at different names. That was the name of a location, actually an island that they like. And it was a name that wasn't chosen for any other roads in town, so it seemed to fit. And so that's what they would like to go with. There's also a pedestrian easement
shown across the sewer easement, which is in this area right here, going down to Oakhurst Road. When we were at the last meeting and talking with Maureen, with the addition of this land that would be offered to the town of Cape Elizabeth, there was a desire to plan for some linkage through this property to the town land. And the applicant has agreed to provide a pedestrian easement across that sewer to help continue that linkage through that. And with that said, that would conclude my presentation. We'll be more than happy to try to answer any questions. We're very pleased to be here, and we've tried to work hard to answer all the questions. Thank you.
Kinsey, please go right ahead.
What is the purpose of the trees that are to be planted?
There was some question that with only leaving a 10-foot buffer along this back line, stopping the tree clearing 10 feet from the edge, that there could conceivably be some holes. You know, there could be a tree here and a tree here and a hole through there. And the neighbors over at Cape Woods had expressed some concerns about visual corridors coming through the site. And this is an effort to provide some additional screening. The hemlocks will, they tend to grow up and grow full and through there. So it was an idea, hope to soften any visual into the backyards of these houses.
So they would be hemlocks?
Yes.
And they also soak up the moisture in the soil?
Yeah, hemlocks would do that too. We looked at a planting that would work well with this type of a site.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Mr. Emery.
Just a couple of questions and comments. I'd like to thank everyone who, I guess at our public hearing, we said that for those who weren't at the public hearing or anybody who wanted to be on the public record, in addition to that, please submit letters in writing, if that's not redundant, to the town planner. And we received all of those letters except for a couple on the table this evening. As I was reviewing the plan and reading the letters, this idea of one-way circulation came up because I kept hearing about the traffic concerns. And about the minute that light went on again, I read a comment in the letter. In accordance with Mr. Emery's comment on the field walk about one-way circulation, there was were those concerns raised there. I think first and foremost, for the public record, this is a previously approved subdivision that's essentially been approved twice. And that's the point of departure that I take. If this came before the board as not a previously approved subdivision, I think things would be quite different than what we're seeing this evening. There were questions raised. I think that the existing neighborhood and the traffic issues are a whole set of issues that I'll address separately. One of the concerns that I've raised at the site walk and I continue to raise as I see the plan is that the grading plan, which I give the applicant a lot of credit for, most times subdivisions are done as a centerline profile with no idea how one meets grade on either side. In this case, the applicant has taken the time and made the effort to show how each lot could be graded, but in so doing has essentially demonstrated that at least with the grading that we see, that there will be no trees left on within the buffer setback from one side to the other. And what the applicant is proposing to do is to plant street trees. I think there's an opportunity. Again, I live in Brentwood, and we have similar sized lots, about 100 by 110 to 120 in Brentwood. And some of the older, or the more recent lots in Brentwood, by recent I mean late 60s, a lot of the existing trees are still on those, were on those lots. In some cases, they've had to have been cut down because they've just gotten old and died. But we didn't have to blast as much ledge. But even on a 100-foot by 110-foot lot, if the house is, as Joel has indicated, is going to be worked within the site, there's an opportunity to preserve existing trees, particularly if they're good stands. If you've got one tall, skinny pine in the middle of a lot, the danger of blowdown exceeds the desire probably to try to save that tree. But I would really encourage the applicant to endeavor to save as many trees in groups of clusters that will be strong trees. If there are mature pines that are strong pines, to work around those. And I think there are two ways of developing a site, and we've seen it at Stonegate. In one case, someone went into what was just almost a quarry. It was a big ledge knoll. And what they did was, I mean, I don't know how they did this, but they took a, as many people do, they just take a plan out of a book, and the site be damned, they literally created a quarry that just blasted the entire site down, put the house in, and the multi-levels of the house had nothing to do with the original grades of the site. And I think what Joel has indicated is he may have to do that if some of his clients want it done that way, but that he wants to work within the site. And I think one of the advantage of if you can do selective blasting is it means that you don't have to smoothly grade the entire site to obliterate stands of trees. If you have mature stands of trees on ledge that doesn't have to be disturbed, that affords an opportunity to protect the rural character in the woodland setting. I would feel more comfortable if areas like that were identified on the plan, or if there was something on the plan that indicated that there was an intent to protect existing trees between the house lots. On the other hand, I guess I respect the fact that they've said we may not be able to do that, and here's the real world situation. It just may not happen. But I think I'd like to put a note in the findings of facts or in whatever the vote is that we would ask the applicant to endeavor to do that as much as possible. Some of the letters criticize the size of the house lot because they don't meet the current minimum lot size of 20,000 square feet. I live on a lot that's 110 by 100, which is certainly, it's almost half the size of a 20,000 square foot lot. I don't use a riding lawnmower. I don't have to hire a lawn service. I have probably 5,000 to 6,000 square feet of lawn that has to be maintained. The overall length of the house with a garage is about 70 feet, and the depth of the house is about 26 feet. Leaves a 40-foot rear yard, and ironically, because the house is elongated north-south, we get light on both sides of the house. The only thing that's happened over the years is the neighbors planted hemlock trees on their side of the fence, which were about 6 feet tall. They're now 15 feet tall and shading out the west sun. But in terms of having, and the house is probably about 2,500 square feet, and I think a lot of that size with a 2,500 square foot house is probably comfortable. If we get into trophy houses that are 3 and 4,000 upwards of 5,000 square feet, and I don't know if there's anything that prevents Joel from doing that, or if in fact that's the client base given how expensive these lots will be to purchase, then the appearance will be quite different, I think. I mean, the houses will start to overpower the lots. So there's any number of things that could come out of this. I want to raise one other issue that I thought was expressed fairly, very eloquently in a letter. There were so many letters, I didn't take time to jot down the names and get the specific comments, but the gist of the comment was the issue of access and safety. And the applicant is right. I wasn't at the workshops and I wasn't in the field when Maureen and all of the officials from the town met and talked about the safety issue and how to deal with it. But the questions raised is that there is an existing wetland which the town has already put a sewer through and has put a pump station in. I believe it's an RP2 wetland. And at what point does it make sense to disturb a wetland in favor of other issues like concern of either traffic safety? I think there's really two issues perceived or actual with the existing neighborhood. Is once you have a dead-end neighborhood and you connect into it, it's always going to be disruptive to the current residents. But then there is a safety issue of coming over the hill and whether the site distance is adequate or not. We have evidence from both sides, both from the applicant and from the neighborhood, that one says it is, one says it isn't. But the question I raise is the question that was raised in the letter, is at what point would that not become justification for utilizing an existing wetland that already has a sewer through it, perhaps sharing the sewer easement if that's a possibility? It seems as though in the pre-approved subdivision that was about where the access was located. And I also say that in the context and retrospect of going over to the Scott Dyer assisted living facility and seeing how close that driveway is to the adjacent neighborhood, because it had to skirt the edge of the wetlands. And as you look at the wetlands, they don't seem to be any more significant than the next wetland down the street. That is, their fields that are reverting from fields to poplars, and they're essentially wet meadows that are overgrowing with other vegetation. I think for the public record, that question that was raised in the letter should be answered. If the town planner could, and I know I'm pulling this out of left field, but I think that was a valid question.
At the meeting that you talked about where staff was out there, The reason we were meeting out there is that the applicant had asked us if he could enter from a different location. So it was, it was initially, the initiative was the applicant's. It wasn't a directive by staff to go in one direction or the other.
Another location being not through the wetland?
Right, right. The original subdivision approval was off of Oakhurst. And the physical constraint of that is that as the road turns northeast, it almost completely parallels the course of the stream that flows through that area. And the applicant's consultant, having worked with the Cape Elizabeth wetland regulations many times in the past, was very sensitive to the fact that we encourage avoidance of wetland alteration whenever feasible. And there was nothing with that wetland that was prohibited from being altered by the town ordinance. The applicant took the initiative to try to minimize wetland alteration by coming in a different location. They were concerned that they couldn't come in off of Woodcrest because there would be a site distance issue, and that's why we were out there to take an initial look at the site distance issue, and we said the same thing out there at the site that we said in the office, which is these are the standards, and you have to meet these standards, and if you meet these standards, you know, then it shouldn't be too much of a problem. But, you know, regardless, you have to meet minimum standards for safety. The issue that was raised by people in the past, and that particular member of the public, was that some wetlands are more valuable than others. Mm-hmm. And in the Cape Elizabeth wetlands regulations, we don't really recognize that. We have two wetland zones. And if you're talking about wetland A and wetland B, and they're both classified the same wetland zone, one of them is not considered more valuable than the other. It's possible that at some point our ordinance might become sophisticated enough to do that. I don't think it'll happen anytime soon, just because our ordinance is already perceived to be somewhat complex to work with. And the idea of being able to take two RP1 wetlands and to write up standards that would evaluate things like flow characteristics and wetland habitat and flood carrying capacity and say that this one is more valuable than this one just seems to probably be beyond our abilities at this time. However, if the planning board or the council wants that in the ordinance, then staff will draft it. It's just that right now our ordinance doesn't provide for that.
Is the wetland in question an RP1 versus an RP2?
No, because if it was an RP1 versus an RP2, that would have some kind of value, because the RP1s are protected much more rigorously, so that implies they're more valuable. The RP2s are also protected, but not as rigorously, so that also implies they're less valuable than an RP1 wetland. But I'm sure we would also have situations where someone would say that an RP2 vernal pool was more important than an RP1 perched wetland.
Mm-hmm.
So right now our ordinance says if you're this kind of wetland, then you should be avoided. It doesn't.
Let me clearly understand again, the wetland in question is an RP2 wetland?
Both wetlands are, if you go the route that the applicant is going right now, an RP2 wetland will be altered. If you go south, the original route, an RP2 wetland would have been altered, and it would have been three times as much area of alteration.
The ordinance allows alteration within the RP2, does it not?
Yes, it does.
And is there a limit in the square footage, at least at the town level?
No.
So it would then become an Army Corps or DEP, assuming if this board were to grant disturbance within that wetland, then the maximum limit of the disturbance would be regulated by the DEP or the Army Corps?
Right, and even then, I don't think there's a maximum limit. They're following the same kind of rules that we follow, which is you try to minimize. You have to show that you're minimizing the amount of wetland that you can alter. I don't think the applicant ever went to the DEP and was told you can't go this route. You have to go that other route. I think they took the initiative. They've been whipped into shape. You shall not alter wetlands unless you have to.
And believe me, I'm not trying to throw you a curveball this evening. And I almost apologize for bringing the issue up this late date. But I think the letter expressed, I think, what is a very valid question. And I don't know if we've had discussion of that question as a board.
Mr. Parkers.
Could I add to this as well? The one comment I want to make tonight about this whole subdivision is I would like to see the access changed to have it go out to Oakhurst Road. I've been sort of looking here as to what the disturbance is, and if I'm not mistaken, it's 3,000 square feet more that won't be disturbed going the way they're going now. I hate to bore everyone, but I grew up in this town, and the planning board's all heard this before. When I was a kid, this was called the Frog Pond, and we used to go down and do whatever we did with frogs and et cetera down here. And I can remember coming back when I was after I had started college, and all of a sudden the frog pond was gone, and in its place was a sewage pumping station. I thought that was fairly amazing, but okay, the town did it, so it must be okay. Well, it seems to me the volume of letters we've had, the public response we've had of the safety concerns of the neighborhood, this wetland in my mind is, I don't know what it really was to begin with, but certainly nothing like it used to be. Why not change it a little bit more and maybe prevent the death of a pedestrian, make the neighbors content that they are still in the same sort of neighborhood that they thought they were buying into. And I think it would be a better thing all the way around for everyone. And I also hate to sort of bring this up at a late date, but I really strongly feel this way and to the point where I don't think I could vote to approve this project tonight unless this is looked at very seriously.
Yes, please, Ms. Masterton.
If you did do as you want to do, what would happen to the wetland, which is going to be expanded in order to take up the moisture that's going to be coming down from the home sites? You are enlarging that wetland, right?
That's correct.
And not only would you not be enlarging it, but you would be filling it. Is that correct? And what? What influence would this have on across the street, that wetland down below? You know where I mean?
Yes.
On the other side of Oakhurst.
Right.
I think you would be disturbing things there that you wouldn't be putting the road going on to Woodhurst or whatever it is.
Would you like me to?
I would like you to respond to that. Is my thinking right?
Yes, it would. What would happen is the road coming down would result in more wetland disturbance. It would result in basically taking that stream, which is identified as a stream, and having to culvert the entire stream down through there. That will require a much higher level of permitting through the state. The permit by rule that we filed allows us to put in a culvert no longer than 75 feet. And when you go to a much larger disturbance, in other words, where that road's coming down through there, we basically have to take that entire stream and pipe it down and have it cross the street. And that would require a much more detailed permitting. And my hunch is that, you know, they're going to question us as to why we're doing that. Is there another way to access the site without completely altering that stream?
You'd have to drain that pool.
Yeah, that road then would come down through here.
By the pumping station. You'd have to drain that. You'd have to enlarge the culvert. And the water would go down below Oakhurst Road.
Yes, that's correct.
And it would flood. Mm-hmm. I mean, it would affect the whole wetland system on the other side of Oakhurst, wouldn't it?
Yes, this design actually provides, because we're enlarging this wetland, we're actually providing
some stormwater treatment and a place to collect sediments before it discharges through that culvert. This is actually like a collection pool. It slows the water down, gives it some interaction with some vegetation down through there, and then it discharges it through. So it slows the water down, provides some detention, and then it discharges it through that culvert. One of the things that came up in this whole process was the concern for downstream. I think Steve Harding's letter talked about that a little bit. There was concern that if we increase this culvert size and we send a larger charge of water down through there, there's concern that that would have some impact on the downstream areas. So the Public Works and us and the town engineer looked at that. We're going to replace the culvert because it needs to be replaced. It's degraded to the point it needs to be replaced. And then we're going to enlarge this pond and I think basically put it back to almost a pond in through there. That's going to provide a place, some storage volumes for the drainage coming down through that. It's going to slow the drainage down and it's going to keep it to pre-development rates down through there. It works.
Hopefully it will work, but it sounds logical.
Yeah, it works. It should work very well down and through there.
Maureen? Further comments or questions from the board? Mr. Emery.
Yeah, I would really like clarification just to jump ahead on another issue. As I was reading the letters from the attorneys, I had come to the conclusion, I guess, that the Mr. Lurie was doing his, and I don't want to criticize an attorney as how they're representing their client. Attorneys represent their clients however they wish. It's none of my business. But by reading the correspondence that we were getting from the applicant's attorney and the town attorney, it seemed as though Mr. Lurie was not reading the ordinance in its entirety. And be what I would call in this type of meeting either smoke and mirrors or a red herring. And then we have a letter this evening that seems to again attack the opinion of, or criticize the opinion or disagree with the opinion, as they all have a right to do, of both the applicant's attorney and the town attorney. I guess for the public record, I don't think that the public sitting here this evening is fully aware of that correspondence, but I would like to have at least on the town side a clear understanding of the issues with respect to non-conforming lots and whether or not this is a subdivision of record. I think it's quite clear in all of the information put together, but I felt Mr. Lurie's letter this evening was extremely disturbing. I thought that, and I also want to say, I think that the town attorney's letter to Mr. Lurie that was in our packet, its closing paragraph was absolutely stunning in terms of language and the professionalism, and if that's the type of letter that this town is using to represent its public image, then I can't say enough for it. It was a very well written letter. I'm glad I didn't have to write that letter, put it that way. But am I mistaken here, Maureen? Are we dealing with smoke and mirrors that it's trying to get the last possible issue that might try to confound the planning board as to finding a reasonable decision this evening?
Mr. Emery, you and I probably work with attorneys a lot.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
We work with attorneys a lot, and there's usually a lot of different opinions, and I've never seen two attorneys call me up the same day so excited. And both the town attorney and the applicant's attorney, it should be made clear that when the applicant first came to the planning office with this proposal, he was told very clearly not to come back until he had verified that this was indeed a grandfathered subdivision. He was expected to hire his own attorney to do the research, to prepare a written opinion that our attorney would then review. The applicant did that. Our attorney reviewed it. There was general agreement that this is, in fact, a grandfathered subdivision. As you said earlier, we can talk about what the subdivision would look like if it was brand new and it came before us today. But that doesn't seem to be the case. Since then, Mr. Lurie has come forward. He's reviewed the file. He's made several arguments. I believe all of those arguments have been responded to by the town's attorney and by the applicant's attorney, to the point that I spoke with Mr. Hill, and He said, I received the most recent letter. I want to respond. He's a pretty easygoing guy, but he felt very strongly about this. Was more than willing to come to the meeting tonight. I just don't see how we can ignore the non-conforming provisions of the zoning ordinance. This town has always had non-conforming provisions in its zoning ordinance and exhaustive non-conforming provisions in the zoning ordinance. There's drop-dead minimum lot sizes under which you are not allowed to build on a lot at all. Wherever this applicant has changed a lot line, any lot line, the lot has been brought up to the minimum lot size of 20,000 square feet. There's no doubt in my mind, based on everything that I've read, that this is not a grandfathered subdivision, and that any place where there should have been an expectation to comply with the current requirements of the RC zone, that had been done.
I raise the issue because I know who the attorney representing the neighborhood is, and I know that he was a, I don't know if he was a land use attorney, but he certainly was an attorney corporation counsel for one of the major cities in this state. And to have such a basic disagreement on what I think is a very basic part of zoning, section on nonconformance and grandfathering, I was very, very surprised by the approach taken. But nonetheless.
Chairman, on that
Mr. McNichols.
Point, Mr. Laurie is not here tonight, and I probably, in the last analysis, will go along with Mr. Emery on this point, but interesting to note that in the letter submitted by Mr. Laurie on April the 1st, he cites two cases from our law court, both to the point. And I'm quoting now from, I think, page 3, third paragraph, counsel. We have often stated that a non-conforming uses are a thorn in the side of proper zoning and should not be perpetuated any longer than necessary. The policy of zoning is to abolish non-conforming uses as swiftly as justice will permit. Now, it's clear in our own code, in our own, that there are some problems, that the non-conforming lots aren't really discussed in the detail that one would like to see. Again, from the last page of his letter, last full page, in this case, if it is appealed, the court will review this board's decision, not on the advice of the town attorney, but for errors of law. Municipal attorneys make mistakes, and boards are free to reject advice as to the construction of ordinances when they believe that legal opinion is incorrect. I think that however this comes out, that a note should be made to go back over the ordinances and look very definitely to the sections that Mr. Laurie highlights in his memo at 16.3.1, 16.2.5, and 19.4.3. And look so that we don't run into this problem again. I think they could be clearer. I think that non-conforming lots should definitely be spelled out in clearer language so as to avoid this problem in the future.
May I raise a basic question to that premise? Is that his premise is discussing non-conforming use? We're not a non-conforming use in this zone, are we?
It's non-conforming. It's a non-conforming lot, isn't it?
Yeah, which is quite different than a non-conforming use. So, but anyway.
Further comments from the board?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, please.
If it's appropriate, if I could take a moment
right ahead,
just
one.
To... sort of had a chance to digest what was talked about as far as the location of the road onto Woodcrest. As I thought back through this, we had originally even come to the board with last summer, with the road, you know, building this subdivision out to the 19 lots as originally approved, and coming out down here on Oakhurst. And we went, after we did that, we went out and started mapping the wetlands, looking at the drainage out through there, and it was obvious that there was going to be a major stream, have to relocate a stream significantly, and there was going to be a much larger wetland disturbance in through there. We had a lot of concerns after speaking with Public Works and the town engineer about what was happening downstream from this site. I guess there's, Maureen, you're going to have to help me out on this, but I believe there was a weir structure or some sort of a dam structure further downstream, and there was some concern about increasing the water, the rate of water coming down to that weir. And there was a lot of concern expressed over that. Once we mapped the stream's location in the field, it became obvious that we were talking, you know, over 200 or more feet of piping to relocate that stream. So that became a major concern. The DEP doesn't look too kindly on us moving stream segments like that. So we became very sensitized to that whole issue. And you're right, I've, over the years, become very, very careful when I come to Cape Elizabeth about the wetlands ordinance. I mean, we've worked with it enough. So there were really two issues, or three issues, going on that drove us to change the design. One was the town's wetlands requirements to minimize the wetlands. Two was drainage and downstream considerations and effect on that stream that's coming through that site. So we took a hard look at all of that. And like I said, we originally had showed coming down over to Oakhurst through that easement. But I think when we were at one of the board meetings, we started talking about the wetlands disturbance. I think Nancy and I had a little discussion about that, you know, the impact of the wetlands and the drainage. And we really went back and spent the better part of 2 or 3 months looking at that, because it became such an important issue. Given the wetlands locations of the streams, we actually ended up doing a high intensity soil survey over the entire site, because it became obvious that there were some things happening with the wetlands, and we had to look very closely at that. So Mark Hampton of our office test pitted and mapped the whole site. So all of these factors came together and said that we needed to go over to Woodcrest. When we made that decision, we even spent more time looking at that intersection, traffic considerations out there. I learned a lot about how Cape Elizabeth set up their ordinances for traffic and maintaining the rural character and the type of road designs that they wanted to encourage. So we felt on balance that this was a better way to approach this project, and it's taken us literally, Joel probably thinks it's longer, but it took us literally 9 months to get to this point, and that's fine, because we wanted, you know, Joel made a commitment to taking the time to looking carefully and moving slowly, and there was, you know, periods sometimes of a couple months, 3 months before we came back to the board, because we were cautious over this. So I think we have the right approach and the right design for this, and I would hope that the board would consider that tonight. Thank you.
Mr. Emery.
Just a follow-up question. I think if I'm hearing you correctly, I don't know of any situation similar to this that the state would allow you to divert a stream for 200 feet. I don't think that's permittable. In your professional opinion, is that permittable under this type of development?
That's a tough one to answer. You know, anything is permittable under the right circumstances. I can speak from past experience on projects where we've done wetlands mitigation, and 99.9% of the time the first question I get asked is, what are your alternatives? Where else can you go? You know, why do you have to put your road here? And we do a fair number of road crossings, and I almost always get asked that question. You know, why does it have to go here? Is there another point of access? And, you know, in this case, you know, we do have another point of access. And, you know, we've looked very carefully at that access. I mean, before we even started the design plans, we went out there and made sure we understood what the site distance was, what criteria was used for measuring that site distance. And, you know, I even looked at it first from the MDOT, the ITE traffic standards, and I said, well, you know, it doesn't meet those standards, but town has adopted different standards because of what the focus that they want for road intersection and development. So we looked at that real closely before making the commitment to move on to this one. And I suspect that if I went to the DEP, they're going to challenge me on that. I know they will. I mean, past experience tells me if I'm going to call for that.
I don't know how you, I clearly understand how you could get a stream crossing, but to redirect in a stream over 200 feet, I think, would be a very challenging thing. I'll ask the question another way. Is it possible to build the road as it was originally approved in the subdivision, the grandfathered subdivision, without having to realign the stream?
No, it's not. We did look at that. Because Joel ended up losing, he could have had 19 lots, and we ended up down to 13 on it. And he directed us to really look hard at that. And I just couldn't find a way of doing that.
How do we, I guess this is a rhetorical question perhaps, but we heard repeatedly, or read repeatedly in our letters, the issue of site distance and public safety. We have Bill Bray talking about a distance of about 200 feet, if I'm not mistaken. And the ordinance is as little as 125 feet. I guess for the television audience and for the final wrap-up on this, perhaps either the applicant or Maureen could discuss that difference. I think Maureen has covered it fairly well in her memo, but just for the public record and for the benefit of those who have come this evening and those watching.
If I respond, I'd probably just read right out of your memorandum, if that's okay. I would, if that's okay, Mr. Emery.
Sure.
Okay. This is from Maureen's discussion. The town engineer's comments are attached, and then she goes on to talk about proposed roads. The proposed road conforms with the recommendations of the 1993 comprehensive plan. The comprehensive plan transportation goal is to provide a safe transportation system that meets the needs of both residents and non-residents. The objective is stated to ensure that intersections and roads adequately meet year-round demands. To implement the goal, the objective, several recommendations were made, including the following. Revise the existing dimensional and construction standards for arterial, feeder, and local roads in order to provide flexibility to ensure that future road improvements result in a minimal loss of the town's rural character. Revision should include: reduce the travel way and shoulder width standards for all roads except for arterial roads. Eliminate the town standard that requires the entire road right-of-way to be cleared of trees and vegetation. In December 1992, the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board recommended to the Town Council a package of road classifications and standards revisions to the zoning and subdivision ordinances. To quote the Planning Board, and this is in quotes, these amendments represent over 2 years of work by the Planning Board to address a priority of the comprehensive plan and a concern with the final construction of recently approved subdivisions. The proposed road classifications and companion standards are intended to produce roads that are more in keeping with the character of the town of Cape Elizabeth. During the 2-year process, the Planning Board reviewed the standards endorsed by the Institute of Transportation Engineers, that's the ITE, and contrasting standards proposed by neo-traditional town planners. The board also had staff prepare an analysis of existing town roads which they felt embodied the desired rural character, and that's in quotes. Five locations on Oakhurst Road and Robin Hood Road were specifically measured for typical horizontal and vertical site distance. One of the products of this effort was the creation of a road classification standards table, which enables road standards that should reflect Cape Elizabeth's rural character, as described in the comprehensive plan. In May 1993, the council adopted the new road standards, including the road classification standards table. And then it goes down and says B, street design. The current town road standards reflect not only the local road character, but also a growing school of thought that wider, flatter, straighter roads enable higher speeds that may be inherently more dangerous. Those typical Cape Elizabeth roads that wind around wetlands and over ledge discourage higher speeds and are safer. The road standards used by the planning board include the road classification table. The site distance requirement for local roads is 125 to 150 feet. This standard was adopted to promote slower speeds, create roads with typical rural character, and retain existing trees, stone walls, rock outcroppings, and other natural slash cultural features when undertaking road improvements. And then it's in parentheses from the comprehensive plan. The applicant, the public works director, and Mr. Bray, traffic engineer, have measured the site distance of at least 125 feet. When I measured it with the public works, we were over, I think, 134, but we're all in that range. I'm not going to quibble over that. And that ends the reading on that.
Thank you.
Certainly.
Owen, I have a question. You made a comment in passing about the roads a moment ago that if the access road were brought back to where it was originally proposed in the original approved subdivision back entering off on Oakhurst Road, that Fitzpatrick Associates could then, if they wanted to, redesign the subdivision and go with the original 19 lots?
Well, they could not get the entire 19 lots, even if we moved the road. What I was originally, Joel wanted, he wanted to get all 19 lots in there, bringing the road down in through there. We might be able to obtain one or two additional lots, but we would never achieve the 19 lots because of the wetlands, the stream configurations, and all of that.
It is a proper conclusion, though, that with the new proposed location of the road that you designed, the subdivision ends up with less lots than if they left the Oakhurst Road access.
Yes.
Thank you. Yes, Ms. Manson.
I'd like to make a motion.
Please do.
Motion for the board to consider findings of fact. One, Fitzpatrick Associates is requesting subdivision amendments, a resource protection permit, and a private access way permit for the previously approved Hemlock Hill subdivision located at the end of Hemlock Hill Road and Woodcrest Road. Two, the application was deemed complete and a public hearing was held on March 16, 1999. Three, the applicant has volunteered to donate open space and a pedestrian easement. Four, a DEP permit will be required for the proposed stream crossing. Five, the town engineer has recommended revisions to the plans that will provide more construction details. Six, the 1993 Cape Elizabeth Comprehensive Plan recommends revising road standards to retain rural character. The Planning Board recommended revised road standards after a two-year process that included an analysis of existing town roads, Institute of Traffic Engineering Standards, and a neo-traditional concept that promotes community character and traffic safety. The Town Council adopted the revised road standards, including the road classification standards table, in May 1993, and the Planning Board has applied these standards since that time. The applicant has proposed a stormwater plan that reduces post-development flows below pre-development stormwater levels. Eight, the combination of non-conforming 10,000 square foot lots and conforming 20,000 square foot lots proposed in the amended subdivision complies with the zoning ordinance. Nine, the application substantially complies with section 16-2-5, amendment to a previously approved subdivision, section 19-8-3, resource protection permit, and section 19-7-9D, private accessway permit. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted, the application of Fitzpatrick Associates for subdivision amendments, a resource protection permit, and a private accessway permit for the previously approved Hemlock Hill subdivision located at the end of Hemlock Hill Road and Woodcrest Road be approved, subject to the following conditions. One, that the applicant submit a pedestrian easement for the area over the sewer easement and an open space deed to the town planner in a form acceptable to the town attorney and town manager. Two, that the applicant submit to the town planner the DEP stream alteration permit. Three, that the plans be revised to reflect the comments of the town engineer. And four, that there be no alteration of the site nor issuance of a building permit until the above conditions have been met.
Thank you. Second by Mr. Griffin. Further discussion, Mr. Emery.
One question for clarification to the applicant. In the clearing of the site, is that going to be multi-stage? In other words, you're going to do the road and then you would go back and do the individual lots, or are you going to hire a forester to clear the entire site at one time?
Joel and I have talked about that would be done in a stage. Initially, clear what's needed to construct the roadway up through there. And then I think as Joel gets buyers and house designs for each of the lots, he would work to fit the house to those lots. And I know that we've had a lot of discussion, and Joel has told me, he says, I don't have to do it like this grading plan, because
no, I understand that.
He really wants to, you know, it's his name, and he wants to have some character to it. So the plan would be do what we need to get the road in, and then Joel will work on each lot as we go.
Would you mind it being a condition of approval that the road be done and then the lots be done individually based on the requirements of...
I don't want to speak for Joel, but I don't think that's a problem at all. We've talked about that.
Thank you. I'd like to add a...
Mr. Emery, go ahead.
...condition similar to that.
Five.
Condition
number five.
That's correct.
Are you asking Maureen to word it for you?
Yes, I think I will. Essentially what it says is the road clearing will be done for the road and the lots will be treated separately.
I'll accept that amendment.
Thank you.
Mr. Griffin, do you have any objections to the amendment?
Sir.
Thank you. Further discussion? Those in favor of the motion, please do so by raising your right hand. Those opposed? There is one opposed. Mr. Parkhurst. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you for taking the time to review this project.
Thank you.
Members of the board, the last item on the agenda, unless there is substantial discussion, the only thing we have to do is make a motion to table it and schedule a public hearing.
Mr. Chairman, I have a motion.
Yes, Mr. McNichols.
Based on the materials and facts presented to the town plan district zoning ordinance and zoning map amendments be tabled for the regular May 18, 1999 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Thank you. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Parkhurst. Any further discussion?
Point
all
of clarification.
Favor? Excuse me?
Not so fast.
Okay, Mr. Emery.
Point of clarification on the exhibit. There's a 100-foot dimension that we all know about along Spurwink Avenue. Just to be sure that before this is up, we know whether that's from the edge of pavement and a line of road or the right-of-way. It's from the right-of-way. Okay. Never mind.
All those in favor? Opposed? None. There is a very quick workshop meeting. Should we move? Yes. We are now off the air. This is... Oh, I need a motion to adjourn, please.
We'll move.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin. Thank you, Mr. McNichols.
Do you remember that?
Motion before the board to adjourn. All those in favor? Thank you. Good night.
You going in the other room?